Did you know that type hints, one of Python's most impactful features, started as an idea in a document called a PEP? Here it is. This is PEP 484. This PEP clearly had a huge impact, but what's even more interesting is the process behind it. Every major Python feature follows a journey that starts with a Python enhancement proposal, a PEP. In this video, I'll explore how Python gets new functionality and how PEPs have a huge role in this by looking at PEP 484 and its interesting backstory. Now, while doing my research for this video, it was a lot of fun actually diving into some old internet archives. In fact, I might just start a second channel doing reaction videos to old newsgroup articles. Finally, Microsoft XML Notepad has been released by Bill, Steve, and the boys and gals. It's pretty good. I've been waiting for this since minus 27 years. Oh yeah. Ah, snap. Let's rewind to where it all began. Python was created in the late 1980s by Guido van Rossum, who wanted a programming language that was powerful and easy to use. He released Python's first version in 1991 as an open source project. The language quickly grew in popularity. Guido led Python's development for nearly 30 years. During that time, he earned the title Benevolent Dictator for Life, or BDFL. In 2018, he stepped down, calling this his permanent vacation. Over the years, Python's popularity exploded. Today it's supported by the Python Software Foundation, PSF, a non-profit organization that manages Python's intellectual property, hosts events like PyCon, and funds Python-related projects. While the PSF provides organizational support, the steering council is responsible for Python's technical direction. This council is elected by the core developers and decides which major changes get approved. Of course, Python's evolution wouldn't be possible without its contributors. Thousands of developers dedicate their time and effort to keep Python growing and improving. Now, these contributions aren't just random commits to the Python repository. Every major change is guided by a structured process centered around Python enhancement proposals, or PEPs. A PEP is basically a document that introduces a new feature, explains a design decision, or outlines a process related to Python. So these are also the three main types of PEPs. The standard track, these propose new features or implementations, like PEP 484. Informational, these provide guidance or explanations to the community. PEP 0 is an example of this. This is basically the PEP that is an index of all the other PEPs. And the third track is process, which basically describes changes to the process of the Python language and everything surrounding it. A good example of that is PEP 8, which is a style guide for Python with recommended things to do when you write Python code. PEPs are stored in a dedicated GitHub repository, making them publicly available for everyone to review. Every PEP starts with an idea, but its journey to becoming part of Python is no small feat. Let's break it down. So here's the PEP workflow. We first have the idea stage. Every PEP begins with a single focused idea. For example, PEP 484's idea was to bring type hints to Python, a major change. Now, once the idea gains community support, the author or PEP champion drafts the proposal. Next stage is submitting a PEP. To do that, the author needs a sponsor. Usually that's a core developer or a member of the steering council who acts as a mentor. The draft is written in a specific format and submitted as a pull request to the PEP GitHub repository. Here you see an example of PEP 484 and the file that's in the GitHub repository. PEP editors then review the draft for clarity, structure, and formatting. If it passes, it's assigned a number and added to the repository. However, not all PEPs make it. Editors can reject drafts for reasons like duplication, lack of motivation, or technical flaws. Then we have the discussion stage. Once a PEP is accepted, public discussion begins, typically on mailing lists or forums. And this is where the community weighs in, providing some feedback and raising concerns. For major updates, discussions often span months or even years. The author is responsible for gathering feedback and iterating on the proposal. The steering council, or a designated PEP delegate, oversees the discussion and ensures that decisions align with Python's overall philosophy. Finally, we have implementation and review. After a PEP is approved, it moves to the implementation phase. The changes are added to the C Python codebase, often with detailed pull requests and commits. For PEP 484, the implementation started with this specific commit by Guido on May 22nd, 2015. And after the changes and after iterating on it, it ended up in Python 3.5. Understanding the PEP workflow gives you a glimpse into how Python continues to evolve and how much thought goes into every feature we use. We're all continuously learning. If you're looking to level up your skills, check out today's sponsor, Brilliant. Brilliant has thousands of interactive lessons in Python, but also math, data analysis, and AI. Using Brilliant is an effective way to support your skill development because their first principles approach helps you build understanding from the ground up. Brilliant helps build your critical thinking skills through hands-on problem solving, not memorizing. So while you're building real knowledge on specific topics, you're also becoming a better thinker. Learning a little every day is one of the most important things you can do, both for your personal and professional growth. Brilliant makes it easy to learn anywhere right on your phone, with fun lessons you can do whenever you have some time. Myself, I've been using Brilliant to learn more about data science and AI. They recently launched a ton of new data science content, all of which uses real-world data to train you to see trends and make better informed decisions. For example, here's an interesting case study that analyzes Airbnb data and finds the best place to buy a rental property. To try everything Brilliant has to offer for free for a full 30 days, visit brilliant.org/ArjanCodes or scan the QR code on screen or click the link in the description. You'll also get 20% off an annual premium subscription. Now back to the video. Let's take a closer look at PEP 484, the document that brought type hints to Python. Actually, when this idea was first proposed, it sparked a lot of debate because, of course, Python is a dynamically typed language and this reeked of static typing and people really didn't like Python going into that direction. Guido himself was a champion of this PEP, but even his direct involvement didn't make this an easy sell, as you'll see in a minute. One of the earliest decisions was to make type hints optional. You can actually see that already appearing in this very old blog post by Guido. This blog post already contains quite a bit of technical discussion about how Guido envisions the type hint system to work. So for example, here he already says that he prefers this type of return type over using something separated by a colon, because that's kind of confusing since that's already marked as the end of the function. He also talks about more advanced things like container types, generics, and there's also already some discussion about overloading. So basically you have the same function name with different arguments of different types. Now, obviously this decorator didn't end up in Python. However, nowadays we do have the single dispatch decorator, which looks a little bit like it, except of course you need to import that from functools and then register the function in this way. So it's a bit different, but it's kind of the same idea. Now, as part of his blog, you can also write comments. There's basically 49 replies here. This is like old school internet, right? So here's kind of the post by Guido, but if you then scroll down, then you see that people really start to discuss about this implementation, how this is supposed to work. So I didn't read all of these comments, but it is actually quite interesting to read a few of them and see how people are discussing and what are the kind of things that they're thinking about. So if you're interested in that, I would definitely recommend that you take a closer look at this. It's quite interesting to read. Now, it seems that Guido got a lot of flack for writing this post. So on January 7th, he posted another blog called Stop the Flames. And I really like the writing style. It's quite funny, like it spurred some flames, what I call the NIMPY, not in my Python crowd. You can definitely imagine people thinking that way, like, I don't want types in my Python. Get out of here. And then when you scroll down, you see that there are now even more comments about this. So this is definitely something that was alive in the community around that time. Another hot topic was the syntax for type hints. Should it look like annotations in other languages, or should Python invent something completely unique? In the history of GitHub issues, you can find interesting discussions around this. For example, this discussion is about how to annotate variables, and most of this from how MyPy worked at the time. So there were these two options where you could either specify a type in a comment, or you could do it like so. And then here he already mentioned something that actually ended up in Python, in that we can actually introduce variable notations that look like this. And nowadays, of course, we even have the lowercase list type that we can use instead of the uppercase, which we still need to import. And one thing that you see here that didn't end up in Python is that we have a var in front of it. So of course we don't need to write that. We can actually just write it like so. So I thought that's quite interesting. So here I have another one, which is a discussion about the proper way to spell the type of a callable. And there also, it's a discussion about, hey, how do we actually deal with function types, right? And this is clearly a difficult discussion. I actually don't really like the callable syntax myself. I think it's not that clear. So If you don't know about it, this is basically what it looks like. So you have the callable, and then you specify in, let's say, the square brackets, another list of arguments and a return type. I find this is actually pretty hard to read. And also, you can't really specify the types of these arguments as part of the callable. So for me, this doesn't really work that well. It's kind of hard to read. I find other languages have a better way of expressing function types. So it's pity Python went with this, but it also has a lot to do with the already existing syntax of Python. So I guess we're just gonna have to live with it. Now, following all of these discussions, the community eventually settled on the now familiar syntax that we use for type annotations in Python. The reasoning for this was clear. We wanna keep it readable and simple, which are the hallmarks of Python. Another challenge was ensuring that type hints wouldn't break older Python code. And this led to the decision to introduce type hints as annotations stored in the annotations DOnder attribute of functions, leaving them unused at runtime unless explicitly processed by tools like MyPy. Now, like all PEPs, PEP 44 went through multiple iterations before reaching its final version. Early drafts proposed more complex features, but as you saw on the blog post, the community pushed for simplicity. So the typing module was introduced to centralize type-related tools like list, dict, and optional. The focus remained on static analysis tools like MyPy, rather than enforcing type checking at runtime, ensuring Python's dynamic nature remains untouched. After months of discussion, refinement, and collaboration, PEP 484 was finally approved by Guido van Rossum and the PEP delegate. The implementation began with changes to the CPython codebase. The new type hinting functionality was introduced in Python 3.5 along with the typing module. Even after the initial implementation, PEP 484 continued to evolve. PEP 563 is an example of a PEP that builds on PEP 484 by adding postponed evaluation of annotations. This is actually the PEP that proposes that type annotations are preserved in the annotations DOnder object in a string form. Another example of a PEP that builds on 484 is PEP 585, which adds type hinting generics in standard collections. What does that mean? Well, basically, if you scroll down a bit, you see that actually with this PEP, we actually get the lowercase types that we can use, like list or dict or set, which I really like because then you don't need any import anymore. And I think this is a nice example of how PEPs actually result in innovation, because each PEP basically builds on earlier PEPs to make things even better for us Pythonistas. By the way, if you'd like to sharpen your ability to spot problems in your code, check out my free code diagnosis workshop. It's packed with tips and practical examples for identifying design issues quickly. You can sign up at ArjanCodes/diagnosis. The link is also in the description below. Now, from PEPs to the countless contributions made by developers all around the world, Python's success really is a testament to the power of open source. Every feature, every bug fix, every line of code, it's the result of collaboration and passion. And for that, I just want to say thank you to everyone who contributed to Python. You've made it the incredible language it is today. If you want to contribute to Python, don't be afraid to do that. Not every change requires a PEP and the whole process around it. Smaller fixes like bug patches or documentation improvements are actually just as valuable. The Python Developer Guide explains how to get started. Just like Python has its own way of doing things, so have other languages. It's good to learn a bit about the different programming languages that are out there, like Rust, which is very different from Python, but also quite interesting. If you want to learn more about Rust as a Pythonista, check out this video next. Thanks for watching, and see you next time.